there is no God. You see some of our leaders behave as if there is no God. Some of them behave as if states belong to them. They behave as if people belong to them. But all power belongs to the Lord. Anybody that will ascribe divinity to himself will be embarrassed. Anybody that feels that because they have money and they have means will be embarrassed. There was no king like one of the few kings we had in terms of might and spread and strength in the Bible was Nebuchadnezzar. I'm not sure there's any king that was in terms of accomplishment, in terms of infrastructure, that did things that he hanging gardens, he did a lot of things in his own time. But as mighty, as great as he was, it came a time God said, 7 years, you will be like the goats. You will eat grass. So we need to understand that God is still on the throne. And he said to me this evening, he said, I still rule in the affairs of men. Did someone get that?
Yes,
I still rule. You know, it looks as if the wicked are prospering. It looks as if you are struggling to make it. It looks as if you're trying to do it right, people will look at you like a fool. If you do good to someone, the person will think you're a fool. Just try and be nice, they will call you mugu. Try and be nice to someone, they want to take advantage of you. Just be nice, just help somebody out, they will come again. You see, because man by nature does not know moderation. I cannot for the life of me. I still study these things. Perhaps some of you that have helped domestic staff, maybe you can help me. There is no way you will train, you will take care of the domestic staff that will be enough for you, enough for them. Somebody can just come and tell them one thing and that's the end. You will be surprised that the more, you know, some people cannot eat. And the day you give them food, they will think that, why will you not give me food and give me money instead? Someone went to his village, went to a wedding or burial, I can't remember, of his friend, and saw a young man there related to this man, and took him and said, you should come and drive. He didn't, this man didn't do more than primary two. That was what he did. But somewhere along the line, was a young man, was able to brush up himself well. He would not notice that he wasn't really educated, because of the man who was hanging out with. After like 5 years, he went back and he said, this man is an evil man. And they asked him, what has he done? You live in his house, you eat his food, you do everything. Why is it that he said that every day we carry money to go and bank? Every day you'll be changing car, he didn't even buy a car for me. He has not even bought land for me. By now I should have a car, and by now I should have my own small crib to myself. After all, we are the ones helping him. You're helping him do what? He's paying you salary for somebody that has never did not finish primary school. They're paying you 50,000 naira a month. People are never satisfied. People, I just heard a story of a man that pays his driver 70,000 naira, pays his guitar 40,000 naira, but they connive to steal the car of the wife. This is just happening this last weekend. That is how, and the world thinks that it's good to be smart. We tell ourselves, I say, it's like you are dulling. You know, when we're in school, if somebody that is not, they say this one a Jew guy. So we promote smartness. But our own smartness is not even intelligence to get it right. It's our smartness is manipulating smartness, which is equivalent in spiritual terms to witchcraft. When you manipulate people, in the Bible, it's witchcraft. So when you are dealing with someone, they are dealing with someone, and the person is dealing with you with integrity and integrity of heart, and you have things in mind, it's witchcraft. It's the same thing as witchcraft. If you read your Bible well, you will see it. It's the same thing. If you hate your brother, you're a murderer. That's what Jesus said. So we need to be careful. The things that we teach our children. Promotion comes from above. Increase comes from the Lord. This presentation today is an instruction. I came here to give you an instruction. I came here to give you an instruction. And open your eyes. And open your eyes to some of this presentation, especially this one, is when I train CEOs, I give them this presentation. And I tell them that God is watching exactly what you do. And this presentation, the first time I ever did it, open was 2016. We did our first business school, but it has been there before then. And all this presentation is hinged on one thing. Seek ye first, Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and what?
Righteousness.
And you know, we always forget that righteousness. And there shall be, and all these things shall be added. It is that righteousness we want to understand now. You see that righteousness? We just say, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Yes, that's why you see that somebody will go and do 419 and bring the money and say, is it not the kingdom of God? He will start feeding the poor, go to his village, call all the widows out, and give them wrapper, give them rice, and say, it's the kingdom work. You are fooling yourself. Because there's no righteousness. You cannot mock God. What you sow is what you reap. Call him and die, call him God, bury him. And he will be watching you, you will do what you are doing, and at the end of the day, you end up in failure. Is that righteousness? Because in God's standard, there is no prosperity in the kingdom of God without righteousness. In the kingdom of God, righteousness flows. In the kingdom, righteousness flows with wealth. But you see, the way we have been taught these things over time makes us, coming from a background of, oh, if you sin, you die. Christianity and the world was not broken down to us in bits so that we can understand it and grasp it and live with it. Christianity is a way of life. It's not a religion. It's a way to live. And you should be able to break it down step by step and let people live by it. And not just give them the word, and people take the word and have their own interpretation. And at the end of the day, you see people do not fully understand what the scripture means. And they just feel that, yes, give God his own. And God, so I've heard a man say, the Bible says, give to Caesar his own, give to God. So he can give to God his own, also give to native doctors and give to anything that will make him get his own. He goes to church. He says, it's a knight. He says, but this is Caesar's own. That's man's own. So in his own interpretation, he can use it to do whatever he wants. We have many interpretations, but this night we are going to get into what integrity means, which is the righteousness part. Many talk about it, but few people in our society really know what integrity is all about. Nigeria is in crisis of integrity. Lying, cheating, manipulation are rampant everywhere, in offices, in businesses, in schools, in homes, in governments, and sadly, in some church sanctuaries. This is a report by an institute in the U.S. called Josephson Institute of Ethics in the U.S. And they reveal that teenagers, I want to start with teenagers and go from there, are much likely to cheat, lie, steal than when they were a decade ago. What am I saying here? I'm saying that our children, you see that if you lie, your children will be better liars. Whatever you did, you see that your children will be better. And if they always do a survey in the US concerning teenagers, and these teenagers, you will see a statistics of which I'm going to soon show you, of teenagers, the kind of lifestyle, and anything that is happening in the US, wait 10 years is coming here, if it's not already here. The evidence is that a willingness to cheat has become the norm, and the scary thing is that these teenagers are the future corporate executives, the politicians, the professors, the parents with the dispositions and skills of cheaters and thieves. You find out that in our political setting, you see that there's a large crop of cultists in our political setting. And when I say cultists, these are people that came out from university. There are certain cult groups in the university or fraternity in the university that has moved over to politics. And you will see them and they carry it over there. So if these things are not checked in the university, they will carry it into politics. And they will carry it into the house. And we see them carry out activities like that everywhere they go. They take that same thing they learned in the university and they're using it right now. So if we allow some certain things, and if you allow some certain things in the society and in your home, get ready, because those children are going to become the executives of... I remember my pastor used to say that if you go... This thing is done. My pastor used to say that if you lie and cheat and you sought in the university to pass, and which many people do, then he said that you should get ready also. That when you go to meet your surgeon or your doctor, that your doctor also sorted in school. Why would you sort and come out to engineering and expect that the doctor that would train you, that will treat you, did not sort in school? Or maybe the pilot that will fly you also did not, he sorted in school. This is the system, and that's why the whole system breaks down. We are a peculiar people. We're a peculiar nation. We cannot do things the way the world do their own things. There are standards by which we do things. You cannot, because you are being pressed, we do things based on the way the world has done it before now. The problem is that we have not somewhere in our mind recognized that there are two kingdoms before us, and we must always make a choice, which kingdom do we belong to? We were born into the kingdom of darkness. All of us were born into the kingdom of darkness. All of us came to know that Satan is the God of this world. So before we began to know Christ in our 20s, in our 30s, when you are fully decided that you are going to follow him, you already know the world system. And the world system looks as if it is the only option that we have. It is what is real to us. But we have not really gotten the fact that there is another kingdom. Because we are, see, it's easy. Who taught you how to lie? Nobody taught. We don't teach our children how to lie, but they lie. We don't teach them to do those things, but they do it, because that is the system that we're born into. See, I remember I was watching a program many years ago about in India and in Asia, And in India, even till today, is you wake up, if you like, have master's degree or PhD, your father can come and say, this is your husband. That's all. They don't argue. Even in the northern Nigeria, they don't argue. And they were asking them, and they were, CNN was asking them that, young people, I said, will you? They said, yeah, that this is what we know. It's not a problem for them. And by the way, who says this love, I love you, I love you? Look at the statistics, it's worse off. The people they pair, they last longer than this one you fall into love, fall out of love. Because we think that love is marriage. Love is not marriage. We think that that butterfly in the tummy is not. Love will escort you to the gate of the marriage and tell you bye-bye. When you enter that door and you lock that door, that don't you see people fight in their honeymoon? From the honeymoon hotel, they fight and separate. Where is the love? There is two different kingdoms and two different standards. And those two different kingdoms, they have different standards of wealth and prosperity, enrichment. And you need to understand which one you belong to. After a while, you should settle for one. After a while, settle for one. And this is the reason why Marketplace Apostle was written, so that you can understand what God is God's standard for prosperity, for wealth. You cannot do business and live your life like the world. You cannot. You cannot get up in the morning and what you are looking for is how to outsmart your customer. Someone took me to this Ikoku, I think it was 5 years ago, and told me he wants me to meet one man. And when we got there, started interviewing the guy. The guy doesn't do fake, he won't tell you this is fake, this one is original, this is Japan, this is this. He just sells the original and that is it. It took him like 15 years of almost being in poverty because he says, I have to live by certain standards. Today, he's one of the major importers. In fact, it's his first son that is running it now. He's one of the major importers, and they know that this one is original. So some people don't even bother to import again. They just wait for him to come because his phone is original. But it took him 15 years. Integrity will cost you. It will cost you money. It will cost you friends. So when you want to work for God, there's a cost implication. But at the end of the day, you will end well. At the end of the day, you will sleep well. Because those that struggle to make it, you also struggle to sustain it. There are young men that have made it, but you can see them, they are not successful. I don't know whether I'm giving you a story. I have a cousin, if you see, he's never said, he's talking to you, he's doing this. What is the matter with you? He doesn't drink, oh. It's not like he has his own, but you can see he's hyperactive. He lives in Dolphin Estate in Lagos. So one day I saw him coming and I was following him. He entered, he was moving fast, he entered into Dolphin. He doesn't drive slow, always moving fast. As he entered the Dolphin, he has something, he will press a gate, he pressed the gate, man will start opening the gate. As the gate, he was entering, as he's coming, his house by a corner, he just drives in. So as he was coming, because the gate man knew me, and he allowed me to enter, the guy came out of his car, ran and jumped the fence. Which kind of money is that? Which kind of money is that?
He lives in the UK 3 months. He lives in the US 3 months. He lives in Australia 3 months. He lives, you ask him, say, international businessman. Doing what? What business? I say he flew first out of this thing. I was just standing there, open my mouth. I said, what is this? That is life. That is the, which kind, that is it. Yeah. This were the called boys in school. This were the boys that in school, when they were coming, people were running. They, if he's coming, whatever you're doing, you stand still. Then he will come. He doesn't buy food. He will come in into the canteen. He will just stand. Whoever is eating, whatever you bought, he will just carry, you will eat, and you will walk out. It's those kind of people. But now you see that he has become whatever it is, but you are not. That is the world. This is a guy that will tell you that you are darling. He will tell you this, he will tell you that. The reason why, maybe one day, you know, maybe because his father too was not really at home, but one day he told me, I should do this. There is only one reason why I stayed in school. There is only one reason. And that is if you know the father that you have in your house. You don't bring bad results. Which house are you going to come? When you misbehave and you know the father you are going to come and meet, you will adjust yourself. And that was the saving grace. But him, his own father was not around. And that's the problem. And people learn things. And today, he has friends in high places. What do you think when they sit down, people like that, what do they discuss? Do you think that they will ever discuss about you? Look at these statistics in the US. Teenagers, we're still talking about teenagers. Between 2007 and 2017, the number of high school students who admitted they cheated, lying to parents, that is the fact, that is the norm, 85 to 95. Lying to save money, 46 to 56. Lying to get a job, 58 to 77. So, what this institute is saying is that this is the children that are going to become governors, presidents in the US within the next 10 to 20 years. So, let us begin to look at what is integrity. Because this integrity, like I'm telling you, is God's standard. And look, God's standard is not difficult. We think that God's standard is difficult for us to follow. No, we need to address this thing. If you don't make peace with God's standard, you are going to continue to struggle. And you are going to continue to be swinging between both ways. On Sunday you are repenting. By Tuesday, God forgive me now, but I need to make ends meet. You need to make ends meet. Does not mean that you will fulfill the standard that God has set. A lot of people say that it's hunger. One guy went to do one stupid thing and we had to send money so that they would release, so they would put him on bail. He said his daughter was crying and so he couldn't stand it, so he had to do something. I said, okay, the daughter is still crying, right? But you are inside cell. Let me tell you, hunger and wealth magnifies what is already inside. When you're hungry, it brings out who you are. When you have money also, it brings out who you are. When you're angry, it brings out who you are. So don't be deceived to think that one thing is what is making you do act in this way. It's not. You must accept God's standard for you. We are talking about princes are coming. And those princes that are coming out of Africa, the ones that will organize society and change and create wealth,
In the next 20 years, are people that understand this standard? Because if you do not understand it, then there is an issue. What is integrity? Integrity in Hebrew means strong. It also means completeness and uprightness at a venture. I'll just move on because most of this. It also means upright, moral soundness, purity, honesty, made perfect and entire. Integrity then is the uncompromising desire to do what is right according to the highest standards of behavior in every situation, regardless of circumstances. It's the uncompromising desire to do what is right to the highest standard of behavior in every situation, regardless of circumstances. Regardless of circumstances. So it is not about, there was something, this cough has made me forget, but I wanted to. It's not because you find yourself in certain standards. Okay, look at Daniel, for instance. When I talk to teenagers, I use Daniel to speak to them. Because Daniel was a teenager when we met him in the Bible. Daniel was a teenager when we met him in the Bible. Because he has standards. He has some moral standards that has already been placed inside of him. He says, I will not touch this thing. He proposed in his heart that I will not touch this thing. And God, let me tell you, God rewards faithfulness. You guys, just let me take time and deal with this. God rewards faithfulness. And what is faithfulness? Believe that God will come true. Please, what did Abraham do that righteousness was credited to him? Huh?
He believed.
There was no church. There was nobody that could tell him about this God. But because he believed, he hoped upon hope that God would bring the thing he said he would bring to him. And what happened? God gave it to him, gave him access, but at the same time, righteousness was credited. So what can credit righteousness into your own account is belief. You must believe at any particular point in time that God will do it for you. If God does not do it for you, two things. It's either he doesn't want to do it or it's not the right time. Daniel proposed in his heart that he was not going to eat. Some of us were eating chicken with two hands and two legs. But what happened? God rewarded him for that faithfulness. For that faithfulness. How did God reward him? He gave him favor with the eunuch. As he gave him favor with the eunuch, what happened? He looked fairer than the people that were eating. And he was fasting and eating water and vegetable. But we now saw later down that Daniel 1 that he became 10 times better. When they went before the king, he was 10 times better. Than he was 10 times better, smarter than his peers. And Daniel reigned 4 kings. When God lifts you up, you remain up.
Mm-hmm.
But when man lifts you up, man can bring you down.
Mm-hmm.
When you lift yourself up, make sure you don't make mistakes because you are coming down. You must realize that it's not everything that you win. You must follow God's standard. Do not compromise because you see that the situation is there and there's nothing I can do. See, when there is nothing that you can do anymore, that's when God starts. When your power has failed you completely, when it gets to that point, you can't even eat. When it gets to that point that you've tried all that you can try, that's where God starts. Because that's where God is showing you that, that's where God wants to show you that He is God. That your weakness or where your strength ends, that is where it all starts. So no matter the situation, you must realize that you must trust God. And do like Esther. And say, if I perish, let me perish, but I have to do this thing I want to do. It technically implies inflexible adherence to this high standard of value and code of excellence. Every man must have his own core values. What is your core value? Boundary. I can't go beyond this. And I stay by this. You must have your own personal core values or standards. If not, anything goes.
Yes, yes, yes.
When the problem comes, if you have no already standard, it will just carry you. Integrity is also a person's inward attributes, motives, character, qualities of godliness that outwardly manifest as moral and ethical excellence. So integrity is an internal something, it's not a physical. Integrity is already a process way of doing things. Integrity is knowing who you are, knowing your boundaries, and knowing you can't pass this. Integrity is that even if I cannot kill competition, because that's the way the world does it. Integrity is that this is how I do my business, this is how I relate to people, this is how I want to. Integrity knows its place. Integrity does not allow the world to determine its own place. Never allow the world to determine for you anything, because the world cannot give you anything good. And let me tell you, integrity transcends age, race, religion, education, gender, personality. So it has nothing to do with your religion. Some people know all the scriptures, but they are not people of integrity. Because in their hearts, you have not been able to process it to the extent that you say, I want to live by this standard. I want to be this kind of person. It's a decision. It's not about the scripture you know. It's about the scripture you have decided to live by. That is important. By which scripture do you want to live by? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. You have to teach yourself how to think. You have to teach yourself how to think like a child. You have to weed out the thoughts that you don't want. And you have to place in the thoughts that you want. As a man thinks, so is he. And after the process of thinking that thing that you are, what happened? From the abundance of the heart, that same heart, the mouth will speak. So after you think, the heart has processed it, you begin to speak your mind, and people begin to wonder, what kind of a human being is this? You must deliberately guard your thoughts and guard your words. There was a time that, you know, this thing that we teach, it has to be practical. You need to practice this thing. See, there is no magic. Spirituality is not magic. The things of God, you learn it. You learn it, you practice it. Like riding bicycle, you practice it every single day until it begins to work for you. It's not because you come from prayer meeting that certain things will just happen for you. It's not. The things of God, you need to learn it. The things of God, you need to process it. I remember sometimes, there are many things that practice, because for me, I see that a lot of things in Christianity work for me because I have to practicalize it. Anything I want to do in the morning, the night before, I'm already preparing myself for it. You prepare yourself for what you want. You prepare yourself for meetings with the Word of God. You chew those words within you before you do anything. Anything, you see, when they tell you, I remember I was, someone told me that many years ago that there's somewhere we need to go, I should come, that they're looking for someone to come and speak on a particular topic. It was a professional, this, I said, no, I don't think I can do it. And the guy said, why do you think that? You are saying, no, I don't think I'm able to do it. And the guy said, look, the person that did it the last time, it wasn't even too technical for him to, that he just used, that there's a way. I said, no, I can't. That weekend, the Holy Spirit started dealing with me. I said, look, it's the fear that you have because of, the fear is not in the presentation. The fear was the people you are going to present it to. Because when you are going to speak to people that are professionals like you, some of them are employing people like you. You are the same in the oil and gas, people that have 2,000, 3,000 workers, both local and foreign. People that know the business, then they say if you come and talk to them, there has to be some element of fear within you. Because you don't know what you can say. These people, they know it, and they are looking at you to tell them something that they do not know. And when the next opportunity came up again, the Holy Spirit said, I need to go. Then I need to speak. So I started preparing myself. He has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound
mind.
So for 2 weeks, I was just researching the same thing every single day. And as I, the most powerful one is before you sleep. I can say it over 1,000 times. Imagining those people, imagining those things. And that's how I do. Last night before I slept, I was looking at your faces and I was speaking what I'm speaking now on my bed. Because I've been able to train myself. And so when you come out, you become exactly what you have. It's like you have done it before. People will be saying, it's in your mind, you have done it before. So do you know that the first 2 days, when I think about why did I accept this thing, my heart, my liver will be failing. But do you know by the first week, I wasn't too scared again. I was like thinking of how am I, I'm not thinking of strategy. Fear has gone now, the fear of not being able to do it has gone. Now it's the worry of, okay, which angle will I come? Do you know by the second day, the first day, 2 days to go, a day to go, there was no fear anymore. It was now with strategy. And I just took, within 2 weeks, I've gone from fearful to now trying to be master. And when I got into the place, the Holy Spirit just gave me one word. I just said one thing at the end of the day. Do you know for 1 hour it was discussion?
Glory.
20 minutes we talk football, 20 minutes we talk marriage, 20 minutes we talk. The things that we said about that thing, they taught me the thing we came for. I didn't know it. But the way I guided, they were telling me, they were discussing, I was asking, it was like interactive, we were talking, they were educating me and educating themselves. At the end of the day, when they scored me, all of them scored me A.
Glory.
They have never scored anybody A before. But most of them scored because, it's not because I went, the other people, if you see their degrees, PhD this one, PhD that, but I came from a different angle. I came from a different, because I know now I am working with the Holy Spirit to bring it to pass. And it became easy. You need to, and this is before makes you feel, and when you feel that things are down, you have to believe in this word. Now, if it works, if it doesn't work out for me, it's okay. It's okay because I have seen the ones that have worked out for me. And integrity is knowing when to leave it. God doesn't want it for you. Okay, why does the Lord require that we walk as people of integrity? Because it's only through the building of integrity into our lives that we can reach our full potential and fulfill the plan of God that God designed for us from the foundation of the earth. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." But sadly, this generation has no real knowledge about integrity because we cannot. Integrity is just believing and trusting God and exercising yourself in God's standards. But now, in the Western world, they brought out what is called situational ethics, which is currently reigning in the corporate world. For when you know, when you meet people in the corporate world, you meet foreigners, they have their own idea of integrity. If you meet Americans, you are even American pastors. It's just because this thing is up. I would have said some certain things. The way we take Christianity is where some of them are not taking that Christianity that way. But let me leave that one. There's what is called situational ethics, was better in the 60s. And this mentality says, if an action is good for you at that particular time that the situation arises, it's acceptable as long as it doesn't harm anyone. So, you can lie, you can cheat, you can fornicate, adultery, as long as it doesn't help anyone and it can help that situation, it's called situational ethics. So, in the corporate world, it's allowed that you can lie and do some certain things, commit adultery to bring in business to the company. It's allowed, it's not an issue. So, it's alright to lie if telling lie means if telling the lie means getting caught. Instead of saying the truth, you lie so you will not be caught. Then the 90s brought the idea that there is no absolute right or wrong. And you think this is a joke. To the average foreigner, they can tell you and tell you that it's not, you know, there are shades of gray now. There are different angles. When you see when you are talking to somebody, you say, look, it depends from the angle you are watching it. It depends on how you look at it. And you see that the world now, the world has its own terminologies. Do you know that it's no longer adultery? It's having an affair. It's fling. What are you flinging? It's fling. You know, we are calling it names to bring down the effect. Please, what is misappropriation of funds? Call it what it is. Why can't we just call it what it is? It's because we all realize that we need to call it these things so it's easier for us to swallow. But if we divorce integrity from God, then it means we have to set our own moral thermostat, which will make others very uncomfortable. Abortion, homosexuality has become okay. Become okay. There are cartoons now that if you don't check it, they have homosexual. There is no scene, no movie, no modern movie that does not have homosexual parts in it. None. None. For if you have DSTV, the most families, they go on 122 because there they have a lot of comedy that people can You know, they have something like Big Bang Theory. They have all those type of interesting comedy you can watch. But now they brought Modern Family. There's a program there called Modern Family. And in that place, they have a gay couple from, and the gay couple, they have children. They have a child within that movie. What are they doing? Yes, it's okay. If you ask our children today about homosexuality, if you ask them, they are not taking a strong stand like you. By the time they get into secondary school, they are not taking a... The first time I discussed homosexuality with my sons, and they were aware of it. They were aware of it. My first son was, he was asking me questions about it. He was aware of it. And do you know that in Europe, a 14-year-old, but now the church, the risk is not on the women, it's on the men. It's on the boys, rather. Because in Europe, at 14, you can have a homosexual relationship with an adult of 50. If you're a boy, it's allowed. In Europe. Why? When this thing started, we used to say, kill them, do this, do. But now, they are becoming sympathetic to it. Abortion came, they shouted, what is it now? It's normal. These are normal things because of now, they call it Planned Parenthood, they call it all manner of names to make it easy for the world. So it's no longer God's standard. God is no longer the standard we're using. And that is a problem that we have. Our society has no reference point. I was taught that when you miss your way, my father used to say that if you miss your way in life, go back to the beginning. If you miss your way, you want to start a company, what was the first thing you thought about? Go back to it. But where will we go back to? Which standard are we going to go back? Where are we going to now go back if we have no standard, if we have no Bible to fall back on? And now people are saying the Bible is not the final word. That these are modern times. Somebody was actually saying, let me not say because I have to call people of other faith. But people are saying that in the modern times, that certain things can no longer be used. So we need to downplay and remove some things from the Bible so that it be easy for our children to follow the religion. Okay? There is a school of thought that says that man is basically good. And if he does bad things, he simply doesn't realize they are bad. More education should be encouraged. That's why they don't beat their children. And also, they just did bad things. And let's encourage them with education. And these are the standards of which the world is now being framed. And it's becoming difficult for us to find our way and to know ourselves within this society. Standards based on anything other than God is relative. And relative standards are meaningless. Advertising slogans now that we have, if it feels good, do it. Have it your way. What's the need for me? All appealing to man's selfish nature. This marketplace apostle, someone asked me many years ago, he said to me, I need to find out what is in. People need to know what is in it for them. My in-law, his church asked them to plant a church somewhere in Lagos. And so they went there outskirts to plant a church. And some boys came around and they said to them and said, see, in this thing we control the crowd here. And what happens here is that we will give you the crowd, but every Sunday and every Wednesday, once you collect tithe and offering, give us 40%, you give us, that we don't take check, we just count it, collect our own, And they were, there are people that do that. And they were laughing because they've never heard of such. They say, if not, we will run you out of this place. They came back the following week. Say, how far? They say, no, they're not ready. They say they're giving them 1 week. Do you know, after 1 week, they had to leave that place.
Mm.
Because today, they will break down this side. They will burn this side. They will do this. And people going from church, they will molest them, beat them up. Nobody was coming. They had to leave. They have to leave. All because now church has become big business. And people are entering it to do all manner of things. There are people that can come and, what do you want? If you want to do, somebody has a church of not up to 50 people, but every month is doing conference. Every month is doing some kind of crusade and bringing all over, people all over. And I heard that there was one that people will bring that, it's like conference. After conference, they'll sit down there, you give them their share, then they go. Integrity has become an issue everywhere we find ourselves. Because man just wants to satisfy his own inner yearnings. So a person of integrity is what? Is a sincere person whom you never have to wonder if they mean what they say. You can take their word at face value. How many people these days can you say you can take their word? They mean what they say. There are very few. There are very few that will tell you, go, I'm coming, and they're actually coming. Because even some of our pidgin English sometimes is even deceiving. They go and they come. There are some things that we say you'll be wondering. Even the pidgin English is telling you that person is not going to come, they go and they come. It's not coming. It's not following you anywhere. It's not following you anywhere. There are many things like that you'll be like. See, people will greet you. People say, look, the way they will tell you. Well, some people can borrow money every day. I know someone that is owing like 10 people. Mm. He has the grace to raise funds, to raise debt. But to pay back is a problem.
Mm.
And do you know there are some people that will be owing you? It's you that will be dodging them.
Mm.
Because they will look at you in the eye, they will find another excuse and tell you why they cannot pay you. They will look, they are not afraid of you, it's you that you are afraid of them. That is, a person of integrity is one who can take his words. One that will never compromise their core values. The one that relies on God's words as a reference point. Not only abstains from lying and stealing, but refuses to manipulate others to get his way. You may not be able to lay hands on the sick and see them recover, but you can be honest. Some of the pressures that are happening to prophets and pastors is because people are putting them under pressure to see things and to tell them things. Who says that we cannot pray? Who says, if God ministers, releases a word, fine. If prophecy comes, fine. You cannot live with prophecy. You cannot say you live morning, afternoon, night by prophecy. What if God releases a prophecy, fine. So some people must lay hands on you and they must tell you something. They must look at you and they must tell you something. And manipulation has become easy. You don't have to manipulate anybody. Promotion comes from above. Okay? You may not operate in all the gifts of the Spirit, but you can be a man of your word. For me, if you come and you say, let us pray, I will tell people, let us pray and let's see the glory of the Lord. It's better we are all praying and the Lord will answer and everybody will know that the Lord has answered. When somebody is praying for you, only that person knows that the Lord has answered. You have not seen that the Lord has answered. Okay? So these are the benefits of the power of integrity. Integrity guides. Integrity establishes. Integrity preserves. Integrity upholds. Integrity betters. And integrity blesses your children. And I'll show you why. Because this is important now. I'm going to take it easy here because I need you to get this thing more and get it right into your system. Because this is the essence why I'm here tonight, to tell you from God's perspective that righteousness in that Matthew 6 is very key and important to God. Integrity. Seek ye first the kingdom and his righteousness, and there will be addition. So let's be guided by integrity. Proverbs 11:3. The integrity of the upright shall guard them, but the perverseness of the transgressor shall destroy them. The integrity of the righteous, the upright, shall guide them. Anytime you walk in integrity, the Lord will guide you. And let me show you, choosing a life of honesty, straightforwardness, and sincerity will guide you through treacherous waters. It even keeps you from destroying yourself. Example is the story of Abraham, Sarah, and Abimelech. And watch this. In Genesis, I think it's in Genesis 26. And God said to Abimelech, who took Abraham's wife, he said unto him, yes, I know you did this in the integrity of your heart by taking Sarah, thinking that she was a single woman, for it was I who kept you back and spared you from sinning against me. Therefore, I did not give you an occasion to touch her. When you are operating in integrity, even if you make a wrong turn, even if you make a wrong decision, God will take it upon himself to clearly let you know that you have made a fatal mistake. And I tell people this, I say, look, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of making mistakes. Don't be afraid of failure. Because I always say here, failure is the ladder that leads to success. Sometimes you need to fail so that you find your way. If you don't fail, you'll not be able to find your way. What is required is that when you are working with the integrity of your heart, what happens is that God is obligated to see that you do not come to harm. To see, as long as you're walking in integrity of your heart, God will warn you in your sleep. Some of us here, God gives you dream when he wants to warn you about something. You don't have to be concerned about missing God or missing your way, because God will intervene because of integrity. If you go around lying, manipulating, and deceiving people, then God is not obligated to warn you or intervene in your matter. Is someone understanding being upheld by righteousness?
Yes, sir.
God will, once you are, see, you can genuinely make mistake. Like Abimelech made mistake with somebody else's wife, but the husband said that he was the sister. So it was not his fault, but God would have killed him anyhow. And that's why, but God saved him because he was walking in the integrity of his heart. When you walk in the integrity of your heart and make mistake, God is obligated to make sure that he brings you out of it. So if you are lying and trying to be smart, don't you see that smart people, there's a day, they say, how do they say it? Every day for the city. One day for the owner. That's what it means. And God is not obligated to warn you or to stop you from that. That's what I mean by being upheld by integrity. Once you have it as a business person, as a father, as a husband, as a wife, wherever you are, Please walk in integrity. Even if it means that you walk away and say, look, I have been in a business relationship and I knew that this one was getting to the point of enmity. And I said, Lord, I sow this money, whatever the money is, I sow it to you, and I walked away. 1 week after that, I had something 10 times better, and there was no stress. When you walk by the leading of the Holy Spirit, and when you are moved, when you are walking in integrity, nothing will stop you. But the world has taught us something different. The world has taught us how to be smart. Once you are smart, you are better be smart to the end, though. Because God will not, He will not bring you out. He will not bring you out. If Abimelech had known, or even had perceived that maybe it's this man's wife, he would have died that night. That is what lack of integrity will do. Integrity will establish you. This is the second one. 1 Kings 9:4-5. And if you walk before me as David your father walked in integrity of heart and uprightness, what happened? Then I will establish your royal throne over Israel forever, as I have promised to David your father. That's God talking to the sons of David. If you walk, talking to Solomon, if you walk like your father walked in integrity of heart and uprightness, I will establish you. Integrity comes from the heart, not from the brain. It's not a product of reason or intelligence. Is a product of character. And character is about the heart. And the heart is about belief. The heart is about having standard, having morals. I say, no, this is wrong and this is right. This is where I stop and this is what I believe. This is what is a matter of, you have processed it in your heart. As long as you are an adult, choose which side you belong. You cannot sit on the fence and say that God and business does not mix. That there are certain things in business, you know that there are certain things in business, we have to do it this way. How many people believe that here? We have to start deliverance session for you. No, but I've been in a meeting not too long ago. Some people will tell you they believe, and they will stand up and they give you their reasons. Yes. Even in marketplace, apostle in landmark, people talk about it that they had to do this. Even in night vigil, we used to, somebody talked about he had to do something because this was how it happened. He had to do something, and people justify it. But there is no ignorance in the spirit realm. God's word cannot be changed because you feel that you are being oppressed. You feel that you are not happy with the situation, with the way things are, and you do it your own way. God's standard cannot be changed. It cannot. Integrity is a hard thing. It's not that you don't calculate it in your mind. Say, not do me, not try me, not let me do this one too. It's not God's way. And when you don't do by integrity, God is not obligated to save you. You know, every action has what?
Reaction.
You know, first to slap is sweet. First to start fight feels, and you feel as if you are strong. You feel, because you don't know how people are going to react. You might dupe somebody today, you've been duping somebody today, but you go and dupe commissioner of police, brother, the last one, and that day you realize there's a problem. If you understand, you've been doing things and be getting away with it, but you just see somebody, and the one that is commissioner of police, brother, will be like a weakling self, you can even slap him, will fall, but he has power, and he will come for you, and that day you will vomit all the words you'll be eating. Because God is not obligated. is not obligated to save you. Integrity is a big thing. God will establish and cause you to reign in domain He has preserved for you if you will adopt a lifestyle of integrity. There's no need to lie, cheat, or step on anyone in your climb to climb up in your corporate ladder. No need. No need. No need to compromise. No need. See, everybody has, you see, is David understood that Saul's time was going to come, but it was not him that was going to kill him. When Saul's time came, nobody, he had to kill himself by himself. A time will come. What's the prophet that had issue with Jezebel? Elijah. He ran. But God will not let a prophet use his hand and put his hand into iniquity. God was reserving the one. You know, you think you are strong, but there's one that is mental that is waiting for you. You know, my mom, there's what she used to say, when you have been misbehaving, then she would, the day she's ready for you, say, hey, the person that wants to die has met the one that has death wish. The day you hear it from her heart, is either be running because two of you will die that day. He said, me, I have the death wish, you want to die, we will die in his house. That's how God went to go. That's how God was reserving Jehu. Jehu was the one that threw her out. There was already a prophecy on Jezebel, how she was going to die. So don't concentrate too much on your enemies. There's already a prophecy on them. I want how to take them out. So don't lie. Don't try to compete with the wicked. Their stay is very short. You see them driving five cars, doing all those things, you will be getting provoked. Their stay is short. Every guy one time was always traveling abroad. You know, he was a competitor. Every time we'd be praying, I would say, God, I'd like to be like this man. This is my MD. Doesn't like to bring out money. But this one, he's traveling. We did not know that traveling, he had blood cancer. He was going to UK every 2 weeks to go and change blood. Until one day he respond. Do not envy the wicked. You don't need to lie and cheat to remove your brother. You see, people are watching, especially in the corporate world. They rise on your mistake. They will take you out so that they will take your position. See, you can help somebody. I have seen people gang up to remove their manager. And as they remove their manager, what happened is that Lagos brought another person. Every time they remove, they brought. Every time they remove, they brought. Because they never saw them as being able. God cannot be mocked. What you sow is what you reap. You have to be careful. Don't lie, cheat, and step on people's toes and gang up against people to remove them. Because you have removed me doesn't mean you will take my position. It doesn't mean. It doesn't follow. You don't need to compromise your character or self in order to make sales or close deals. You don't need to because promotion is from above. Walk in integrity and God will establish you in such a way that no person or thing on earth can shake you. For those of us that walk, whether if you like walking a man, I have seen it. When I was walking, the greatest account that we had, that I was able to bring to my company, was not, one day I checked all the big accounts I brought, there was none that was by my neighbor. We just leave the office. And we just throw. Sometimes we leave the office, we enter our cousin's house, sit down and watch film, and come back to the office and say we don't see anything. We did all that. But at the end of the day, I realized, the Holy Spirit made me realize that all the big accounts we got was not because of my labor. It showed me a cousin was directing me to another cousin. That I should go and meet that guy. I said, I don't like that guy's behavior. He said, I should go and meet him that he can help me. 2 years after, I just went to meet him. And through him, we got a deal of $250 million for the company. I didn't do... You see, the ones that click, you don't have sweat. You don't have to break any sweat for it. God is giving it to you.
Amen.
I'm telling you. You see, it's not by struggle. It's not by hitting the CEO, but we will go, let's do this, let's write a proposal. God will send you to the place that you will go and he will turn around for you.
Amen.
He will establish you if your heart asks a word. God, give me one word for them tonight. Isaiah 26:3. He keeps in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on him, because he trusts in him. God will keep you in perfect peace. And that peace is the one that the world can, you know, the world does not understand peace. When somebody abuses you, you want to fight. When this happens, you respond like this. They don't have peace. There's so much quarrel in the world because there's no peace. But God said he will keep in perfect peace whose mind is stayed. So the rent is not, the money for the rent is not complete yet, but you have peace. Because without peace, you can't even be able to think well. Without peace, you won't be able to write proposal well. Without peace, you won't be able to do that work well. God said, but I will keep you in perfect peace because you trust me. Anything that you lose is not meant to be yours. And even if it was meant to be yours, God allowed you to lose it so that you will have sense. When he sends you the next one, you will not waste it. Yes, now. Shebi gave Moses he gave him the Ten Commandments on a platter. The first time. He gave him now. The second time, was it not Moses that went to, he said he should go to the rock and he used his hand to carve out the stone now. Did he break it the second time?
No.
He did not break it the second time now. So it means that God allows some certain things to happen so you have sense and protect it. If not, if of it break it the second time. Out of anger. So we must realize that everything that happens to us is for a reason. When things begin to keep on happening to you, you need to ask yourself, why is it a wife came to, was always complaining to me and my wife, my husband is this, my husband doesn't trust me, my husband doesn't do this, my husband don't. I said, look, let's talk about this trust thing. Yes, the man, you expect this man to trust you under. He said, yes. Now I said, no, but love, trust is accountability. Trust is responsibility. And I ask her, what do you think you are doing that is making this man not trust you? That was where sense came back to her. You must be doing something, because there can't be any reaction without action. She still feels she's in the university. Hug everybody, talk everything, you know, this time. She doesn't know that after 5 years in marriage, you have to readjust yourself somehow. It can't be the same. Past 5 years is a year of transition. There are some things that need to change. You see a man that 5 years ago, he used to be a bachelor cook for himself. After 5 years, he finds it difficult to cook. You cannot adjust. Some certain things you can't do for yourself again. It takes time. What are you doing? And we started going over. She now says, this. That thing was removed. There's peace. There is peace. There must be a responsibility for us to receive the blessing of God. And once that integrity is in place, God will establish you. Let's move on. Preserved by integrity. I think this is the third one. Psalm 25, 21. Let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait upon you. Integrity will preserve you from anything the devil has in his arsenal against you. Integrity. God has said, integrity and uprightness will preserve you. I think there's a psalm that says, something, those that fear him, he protects. Another scripture talks about protecting those that fear him. I will get it before the end of the day. You enjoy the protection of the Almighty God, the protection, preservation, if you walk in integrity. Waiting upon the Lord means allowing God to promote you rather than resorting to manipulation and scheming to promote yourself. It also means letting others praise you instead of boasting of your own ability. Integrity will preserve you. I will continue. Integrity, the fourth one, will uphold you. Psalm 41, 12. And as for me, you have upheld me by my integrity and set me in your presence forever. As for me, you have upheld me in my integrity and set me in your presence forever. Have you ever been in a situation in which telling a lie seemed the most logical thing to do? Because otherwise, we create all sorts of unnecessary problems. What do you do? What do you do? I've asked Christians questions, and some say, I will lie. And God himself will forgive me because he knows that if I do not lie, this will happen. Which standard are you? Because God has already said to you, the truth shall set you free, shall make you free. See, saying the truth, I've told you, integrity will cost you. I still have money out because people just decided to dupe me because they feel, oh, he's a pastor. Integrity costs you. It will cost you. But stay on the path of truth. Stay on the path of truth and you will, that truth will set you free. For some of us, it might be immediate. For some of us, it might be a year after, 2 years after. But every time God allows you to suffer for truth, he will reward you a hundredfold. Every time you stand for integrity, he said to Daniel, Daniel was favored because he stood for integrity. Anytime you stand for integrity, God will reward you and make you 10 times better. So, consider it. Because in the kingdom where you belong, say the truth, no matter what. Do you know you can even admit, some of us that into technical, you see, go to a mechanic will never admit that he did something wrong. Very few of them will say, Oga, please, I did this. Very few. And you will know, they will want to blame it on somebody that is doing your generator. They will mess and break something up, but they will make it look as if it's you and want you to pay for it. They will be endeared to your heart if they tell you, Oga, I made a mistake. Some will tell you, okay, let's split the money because I can't complete it. You respect that person more and you want to keep that person than the one you know that this man is lying to me, but I need this generator because my family cannot sleep in darkness and in heat. Remind yourself that if you maintain integrity, God will uphold you. You can tell the truth with confidence, knowing in your heart that regardless of the apparent consequences, God will always make things beautiful in his own time. He said in Ecclesiastes, no matter how bad it is, God will always make a way. He always makes a way. But he doesn't give you the license, because I said that you should say the truth, doesn't give you the license to say the truth in a way that hurts other people. Some people say, I'm a Christian, so I have to say the truth. Your saying the truth does not mean that you will use the truth to hurt people. Telling somebody the truth without hurting their feeling is what is called being tactful. Being tactful. You cannot just do because you want to advise somebody. You just go, come here. This thing that you're doing, and begin to insult them. I think that because you are trying to say, I'm telling them the truth. The beginning of wisdom is to tell, the sign of a stupid man is the one that will tell, look at the woman and say, this, your hair is not fine. That is the beginning of hatred for you. Yeah. It's better than 1 million men hate you than one woman to hate you. I'm telling you. See, or you just come back home and tell your wife, this soup is not, I've been telling you this is not the way you should do it. It's the truth. The soup is not sweet, but you need to know how to put it. Have you ever heard of this sandwich, sandwich method of talking to your wife when things are not good? You put sandwich, and you praise her, then you drop it small. You praise her, you drop it small. Just like rats, that is. This will be sweet, but with this salt, it will be better. But I'm enjoying it. She's getting the message. You are giving her in small doses. Small doses. It's acceptable. And that is the truth in a way. Even when you want to advise someone, advise them, build, encourage them instead of tear them down. They will be able to take that advice. When you're advising them and encouraging them and building them, than tearing them down as if, see, we're a useless boy, there's nothing. When that person sees you, there is nothing inside of him that want to. But even when you correct him, and you correct him in love, you are correcting in love by building instead of tearing down. So you need to watch the truth. Lastly, a person of integrity stays before the face of God, which means he's never out of God's watchful eye and care. What can be more reassuring that you are forever in the constant gaze of God's attention? Integrity betters you no matter the blow. See this guy? No matter the punch that you face, integrity will make you better. Better is a poor man who walks in his integrity than a rich man who is perverse in his speech and is a self-confident fool. That's what the Bible says. No matter what it is, a poor man who walks in integrity, God will soon better that person and can no longer remain poor. The power of integrity sees to it that life of an honest and straightforward man is ever on an upward progression and ever growing in influence, responsibility, and greater rewards. Integrity will better anyone. Don't succumb to temptation to abandon it. No matter what it is, integrity, you will come out better. No matter the punches life has given to you. Then this one is for our children. It's very important. Children are blessed by integrity. And please, I need everybody's attention. Because if you don't have children, you are still going to have children. Proverbs 27. The righteous man walks in his integrity. Blessed are his children after him. The righteous man walks in integrity. Blessed. Walking in integrity, your children are already blessed. A life of integrity not only brings you guidance, protection, promotion, it also blesses your children. As you live an upright life, you are laying up a storehouse of blessing for your children, even yet those unborn. Opposite is the case for those who rely on lies and craftiness. Their kids pick it up from the womb in according to scriptures. Women, you be careful. You are carrying a baby and you're lying on the phone. The baby is hearing. There was a child that was separated from the mother. After the child was born, was separated from the mother. But he went many years after, when they were trying to locate the child, the woman was now in court and was saying, this was what I would do. The
The judge was asking her a question. I was like, this is the song that I used to sing for this boy. I know. And as he started singing, the guy from somewhere now started singing that they've not met before. But the guy could recognize that song because he was hearing it from the womb. If you're lying, whatever you are doing, your children don't copy what you say. They copy what you do. And this is the scripture. Psalm 58:3. The ungodly are perverse and estranged from the womb. Can we put our phones inside? The ungodly are perverse and estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they are born, speaking lies. So, some of the things that we see in our children is started from the womb. Teach them, once you walk in integrity and say, I'll be saying that my children need to eat, and because of that, let me compromise. What you are doing is that they are not being blessed because of you. They are not being blessed. Even as a child develops in the womb, the course of his life can be affected by what you say or do. No matter what stage of your life your children are in, you can make a quality decision right now to live a life of integrity and watch God bless your children. So let me move fast now, talk about how to live in integrity. Raise up a standard. Maintain standards during temptation. Taking God's words and instructions as your reference point in all situations. Blending with the right crowd, club, association, and communities like ours here in Marketplace Apostle. You must be in the right crowd. Know God's words and instruction concerning where you are. Maintain standards. Okay, raising up a standard, we see in Isaiah 49:22, the Lord says, thus says the Lord God, I will lift up my hands to the Gentile nations and set up my standard and raise high my signal banner to the people, and they will bring their sons in the bosom of their garments, and their daughters will be carried upon their shoulders. We are ambassadors of Christ. We must raise up a standard through the way we live. He's talking about how we raise up a standard through the way we live that our children and others will follow. And that standard is what draws the unbelievers and our Gentiles to God. If the truth be so told, we have not been shining like the light of the world, and that is why the world is in great darkness. If we live a life of deceit and manipulation, God is not glorified, and people are not drawn to God. Also, the standards we set, good or bad, is not only displayed in our personal life, it is raised in our homes and churches as well. What I'm saying here is that whatever we want to see, without that standard, it is affecting every single thing that we do. Our business, our home. We might not change the world, but we can change our world. We can change the way we see things. We cannot be talking about corruption and manipulation. All of us are corrupt and all of us manipulate on a daily basis. Maintaining a standard during temptation is also because if you do not have that standard during temptation, before, when there's no standard comes during temptation, before, we all intend to be honest, straightforward, and sincere, but compromise when strong temptation arises. Like they say, every man has his own price. So it is impossible to uphold a righteous standard in the face of temptation. So is it possible to uphold the righteous standard in the face of temptation? I'm going through this because I have already said most of this. Isaiah 59:19. When the enemy shall come in as a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up the standard against it. Which standard are you raising? The enemy comes into our lives through circumstances, other people, or our own thoughts and imaginations, and when he does, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. The power to overcome the enemy comes from the Holy Spirit, which energizes and activates our standard. The standard is your integrity.
Okay, I've talked about all this. Let me just summarize here so that we can just say one or two prayers before we go. Traveling the path of true integrity is not easy. If not, most Christians will be walking. The Bible tells us that we are born of incorruptible seed, which means there's an innate integrity in every man waiting to be discovered. So many Christians compromise because deep inside of them, they have not come to really trust God to prosper, protect, promote, and protect them. So they try to do it by themselves. Integrity will guide you, establish you, preserve you, protect you, promote you, bless your children, and please your Heavenly Father. Mm. Lastly, integrity makes you become more like Him, and that is what all this is all about. Mm. This is an instruction of which the Lord asked me to take my time to do this, to show us tonight. The problem is not what you want. No. The problem is God's standard. Walking God's standard. You cannot seek ye first the kingdom of God and what? His righteousness. This is His righteousness. Before the addition, this is the righteousness. And God said, my people shall know my righteousness before they see my prosperity. You must see God, you must know God's righteousness before you see His prosperity. If not, you are wasting your time. We want to serve God in a certain way, and we also want to be in the world in a certain way. We want to move in certain standards to get what we want, but we also want to be in charge. And do you cannot. You cannot be eating from both kingdoms. It's not possible. You have to choose the kingdom. But some of us will ask, why are we getting by? It's because of God's infinite mercy to us. You can't pay house rent. God will make a way to give you money. You can't meet up this bill. God will help you. But that is not God's standard of helping. Most of us still exist based on manna. We're still being fed by manna. Manna is divine food. It's the food for angels. They were just giving man manna, which are temporary rations. Some of us are on temporary relief packages that God gives to us from time to time so that we keep body and soul together. We are supposed to be living from the land. Port Harcourt is supposed to be giving us His fatness. Yeah. That is how God created it. You don't understand. You are walking on the street and you have houses and businesses all over because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And all that walk and dwell in it. Because your Father owns all. Why are you like a beggar? Your Father owns all. Why are you like a servant? It's an anomaly that servants are the ones that are riding the jeep and riding horses. And the sons are trekking every day. By day, by night, the sons are trekking. Because the sons don't want to walk according to God's standard. You cannot see God's prosperity without His righteousness. You cannot. So He will continue to give you temporary packages, relief packages, until you decide to walk, then He will open the floodgate of heaven. And you begin to experience things that you've never experienced before. This is God's standard, and this is what I should share to you today. That you walk by integrity. Integrity is not telling you to be holy. I'm not telling you to be pious and holy and just pray for money. I'm telling you just treat your neighbor fairly. Just notice, help where you can. Don't say because I have 10 naira so I can't release anything. Give to, it doesn't matter, even if you have to starve. Help someone. Do something. Show human kindness. Don't hold everything to yourself. Teach someone the trade. Don't say, no, I need to know, it's only me who gets. No, help someone. Be helpful. Some people, they can help, but they will just be. Even some people you employ, they are paying. They know what to do, but they will not do it because they feel that what you are paying them is not enough. Do what you can do. Give your best at all times. And God will allow the best to happen for you. These are simple, simple things that we know. Simple things. See, if you do not serve somebody, Luke 16, if you are not faithful in another person, so who will give you true riches? And let me tell you, if you are lazy when you are working for somebody, you are not developing that excellence. That valve of excellence can never be open for you when you want to do your own. Mm. Because in practice, you use somebody's own to practice, Abi.
Yes.
Consultants, consultants, is it not teaching us to they learn? Mm. If they were teaching us to put in their hand in their pocket and say, no, when I get to my own hospital, they will never learn. It's in helping people doing things for free that God will give you. Why is it that some people will go abroad and go and read medicine when they want to do internship, they will come to General Hospital? Because that's where you see the real cases that will turn you to a real doctor. It's the same thing in life. When you're doing things free for people, God will give you places where you will get knowledge that by the time you go to people that when you go into the world, people will say, where did you get this thing from? It's because God has given you the opportunity when you were down and helping. Good things happen to you when you are helping, when you are giving your all, than when you are not giving your all. Righteousness is, we already know righteousness in our heart. We already know righteous living. Be fair to one another. Don't be wicked. Don't be wicked. Christians, we can be wicked. Christians, we can be mean. Christians, we gang up against each other. We gang up against each other. We do things. It is not integrity. Do not join anything that you see that is not right. Because don't be in a hurry to make it. God will raise you in his own time. Just be faithful. See that a man diligent in his ways, he will stand before kings. And the Lord will open it. This is the righteousness that we have forgotten. And because there was no righteousness, there's no addition. But the Lord will bring addition tonight.
Amen.
Because he has brought the knowledge of righteousness. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Let's just charge ourselves and just speak in tongues. If you cannot speak in tongues, let's just...